you built a time machine? Kind of a DeLorean?
Hey folks, if you can hear me at home, please log in. It's our first time all doing this together. So we'll be patient as we kind of get our routines worked out. So everybody log in. Make sure you're muted, but make sure your screen's unmuted, please. That'd be great. And we'll try to get everybody in. And that'd be perfect. All right. There's the bell. All right, so bell just rang here at Clarence High School at 9:38. So synchronize your watches at home so you know what time you're on. I'm going to do quick in-class attendance, and then I'm going to hopefully get everybody at home basically off what you did during the Zoom meeting. So that'll be great. Mohammed, are you here? How's it going, sir? Great, Mike. Haley. Yeah. Right, Haley. Hi, Haley. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Jonas. How's it going, Jonas? Good. And we got Sophia. Hi, Sophia. How are you? Great. Evan.
Yeah.
How's it going, Evan?
Good.
Ann. It is Ann, right?
Beautiful.
Got it right. All right. How's it going, Ann? Good. And we got Elizabeth. Hi, Elizabeth. And then we got Nicholas. How's it going, Nick? Is it Nicholas? Is it Nicholas or Nick? I'm sorry. Nick. Thank you, Nick. And we got Anna. It's Anna, right? Awesome. Okay. Thank you, Anna. And we got Grant. How's it going, Grant? Great. And Andrew. How's it going, Andrew? Good. And Sophia. Great. Where are you, Sophia?
Here.
There you are, Sophia. Good to see you. Sorry. In my zone of glaring. All right. Beautiful. We got everybody. Awesome. Man, now I got my people in my Zoom meeting. Let's see. I got to admit a bunch of people. Sorry. Admitting everybody. Come on in, folks, to my Zoom meeting. I'm meeting you all. Come on in. Thank you. Thank you for your patience as we're trying to get this all set up. Please unmute your mic, your video, which is fine. Thank you so much, Nick. And Nick, if you could also unmute your video, that'd be great. Thank you. Next time Nick asks, just give me your full last name, okay, if you can, in the settings, because I want to make sure I know what your last name is. I don't miss you, okay? Next time in your settings, then you can put your full last name, and that'd be great. I'll figure it out for today. But I just want to miss you on attendance, okay? Do you know what I mean? It says Nick S. I want your full last name. That's it. No big deal. We'll figure it out. All right, folks. Welcome, everybody. So today, everybody, we are going to kind of do a little bit of our official course overview and just kind of like have hopefully our official kickoff of being part of American military history, right? Not just, you know, doing all that stuff we did last week, okay? So I'd love to start off class. Kind of with this presentation, and I'm going to share to you people at home too, okay? Oh, I got to admit some people in the, people are waiting to get in. That's fine. Perfect. I missed the chat. Nick Murphy getting zero audio. My webcam died apparently. Okay, Nick, try to figure that out, buddy. I'm sorry. Can people at home hear me? Give me a thumbs up. Can you guys hear me at home? Okay. Awesome. I appreciate it. All right. Here we go. So I'm going to share this screen, everybody. You should see this NU screen coming up on your screens. Everybody at school can see this. Hope you guys can see the NU screen. Can everybody see the NU screen okay? You see my presentation? Awesome. Okay, welcome, everyone. So, you know, I like to kind of say, when you walk in this door or you log on to this Zoom meeting, you're not only part of Clarence High School now, but you literally are part of NAV University. Which you will be once you get through that registration process, okay? So this course is going to be taught very similar to the way I teach it at Niagara University to my college students. I know some people also have Mrs. Fleming this year too. So not only welcome to Clarence High School, but welcome to Niagara University. This is, in many cases for you, your first real legitimate college course. I mean, I know you may have taken AP last year, Gold, World, or Euro, but those are AP classes. They're not real college courses. This is a real college course. And everything we do is what would happen in a real college classroom. You have a real college syllabus, And we're going to do things in that manner that's very much like you do at Niagara University. So it's going to be great. I said in the past, we're going to have some people from Niagara come talk to us. You eventually will get Niagara University ID cards, which was nice because you could have used them to use everything on campus at Niagara. You still probably can go to the campus and use the facilities, use the library within their restrictions. But it does give you some discounts on things like, I think even like Apple Music and other things. Because they see you as a college student. So we're going to give you the ID cards and have that ready to go. All right. I'd like to start off, class, just with some dramatic quotes and just some people I think are important in history, some people that we're going to talk about and look at and examine as we go about our time together. So these quotes, it's one of my favorite. These are the times that try men's souls. The summer patriot and the sunshine soldier will in this crisis shrink from the service of their country, but he that stands by it now deserves the love and thanks of men and women. Does anybody know who that was who said that? You could either tell me in class or people at home. Do you know who said that quote or who that guy is? Anybody know who that guy is? I know it's a tough one. It's not obvious. You can raise your hand. Oh, people are in the waiting room. Oh, come on. I'm sorry. Middle. Sorry. Those who just joined us, sorry, that didn't see you in the waiting room there. That's fine. I appreciate that. Rocco, if you could eventually, guys, Nick and Rocco, unmute your video. And Rocco, eventually change it so I can see your last name, okay? Because I don't want to miss that out. You could mute your audio, but unmute your video. Excuse me. That's what I meant to say. All right. Thanks, folks. So anybody know who that is? Okay, I'll give it. Thomas Paine. Ever hear of Thomas Paine before? What did Thomas Paine do? Anybody remember what Thomas Paine did? What he did, what he wrote? You might remember something he wrote. You probably learned about it maybe like in middle school. He wrote something that was kind of important in middle school for the Revolution. Anybody remember that or not? He wrote Common Sense. Remember that stuff? Common Sense to help the Revolution go on. Well, this case, right, this quote that I had to share with you folks was a quote from he wrote called The American Crisis. So we're actually going to read about it. He became a soldier in Washington's army and joined. And when things are really, really bad, going very, very poorly for the army, Paine wrote this thing called The Crisis to kind of get people back into the revolution and to have soldiers stay with the cause. And it kind of worked. Like the soldiers didn't leave the army because of what Paine wrote. He kind of convinced them to stay through the tough times. So he's kind of an important figure in American history, especially the revolution. Okay, this guy. This is going to be easy. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. Anybody know who said that? In class or at home? You can raise your hands. Anybody remember who said that? Give me liberty or give me death. Remember who said that? Anybody? Anybody? Patrick. Now does it give you a little clue? Anybody want to shout out? Patrick Henry? Does that sound familiar? Big revolutionary figure guy, give me liberty, give me death. Kind of these ideas of these like founding ideas of the revolution. Those are important ones. All right, who's this guy? Now we're getting to photography. Anybody remember who this guy is? Yeah, Frederick Douglass. All right, perfect. Someone in the room got it right away. At home, please, you guys can raise your hands, unmute yourselves, just speak up. Nick, can you unmute your video, please, Nick Murphy, so I can see who you are, my friend? I'd appreciate that. That would be great. Okay, thank you so much. All right, so Douglass, really important figure in the Civil War, and his quote was really powerful. He said, if the Union can only be maintained by new concessions to the slaveholders, if it can only be stuck together and held together by a new drain of the Negro's blood, then let the Union perish. So he was saying, man, let this whole country fall apart. Who cares? Let it go if we're going to kind of only maintain it through like the institution of slavery. So we're going to talk about that more later. He's a really big, important figure in the Civil War, had some important influences on Abraham Lincoln and recruiting black soldiers and kind of changing the course of the Civil War later on. All right, who's this guy? Come on, anybody at home? Someone at home, who is it? Yell out, somebody. Nick, yell out.
Abraham Lincoln.
Nick Yama. Thanks, buddy. Did I say it right? Yeah. Good job, Nick. I appreciate it. All right, Abraham Lincoln, all right? That's great. Here we go. So Abraham Lincoln, this is one of my favorite ones. The mystic chords of memory stretching from every battlefield and patriot grave to every living heart and hearthstone all over this broad land, will yet swell the chorus of the Union when again touched, as surely they will be, by the better angels of their nature. Lincoln was a beautiful writer. He wrote all of his own stuff, and that's from his first inaugural address, where he's saying, listen, the South is leaving the Union. Everybody's kind of going their own separate ways, but he thought over time we would all come back together and kind of fight through this crisis and be a nation again. So we'll spend some time on Lincoln, too. All right, who's this? Theodore Roosevelt. Everybody home knew that, how it was, right? Theodore Roosevelt, right? Perfect. Important person, military leader during the Spanish-American War. Very important president for the military. Built up the American Navy to great lengths to get it ready to be a powerful force in the 20th century. He's got a great quote about history, and it's here it is. Thrice happy, like very, very happy. Thrice happy is a nation that has a glorious history. Far better is it to do dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though checkered by failure, than to take rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy much nor suffer much because they live in the gray twilight that knows neither victory nor defeat. So it's better to at least try, right? Even if you failed, you tried, right? Okay, better than just doing, oh, I can't do it. I'm not even going to bother. At least you try, all right? And this might be a poor quote for all of us this year, man, because we're all trying new things, right? We could be like, holy cow, this is crazy. What are we doing here, right? Well, at least we're trying. We're going to fight through this together. And, you know, it's better to do that even if sometimes things don't work out the way you plan. Who's this? You may not. Yes, miss. I'm sorry. Who are you again? Anna, great. Eleanor Roosevelt, perfect. And again, at home, folks, can I ask Nick Murphy one more time? Nick, if you can, please unmute your video. If you can't, please next time.
My video isn't working. I'm trying to screw with it, and it's not opening, letting me use my cam. So.
Thank you for trying. We'll get it worked out next time. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Okay, Eleanor Roosevelt, she's got a really easy one. The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams, right? It's a simple one, it's a powerful one, but one that I think resonates with all of us. We have dreams and have those ideals, and they will come hopefully to fruition. All right, one of my last ones, one of my favorite presidents because of when I grew up. Who is this? Ronald Reagan. I grew up in the 80s. I remember being 5 years old when he was inaugurated for his first term. And as a five-year-old kid, I thought it was cool that the president and I had the same first name. I was like, yeah, he's big when you're five. All right. So, you know, I remember him growing up, and he was a big person who helped end what war? Home to what war did Ronald Reagan help win and victorious over? You know, want to shout it from home? I'll give you at home only people. What war did Ronald Reagan help win? Big one. Anybody want to raise their hand? Anybody want to try? Jim, go ahead, buddy. Cold War, Jim got it. Very, very, very nice, Jim. The Cold War, all right? It's like a game show host doing this, right? At home, who's got the answer? This is like, this is going to be now. It's going to be a game show. This is going to be great. All right, nice job, Jim. All right, the Cold War, and here's Ronald Reagan's idea. Here's his quote, "No weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women," all right? So there he is. Having that weapon of freedom is awesome. Woo! Okay, there we go. So some quotes I want to show you guys to get the course started. Now, one of my favorite quotes, I don't know who wrote it, but I think it's important. Good is the enemy of greatness. And I'll leave it to both sides of the room. Anybody wants to take a shot at that? What does that mean? People in class or at home, what does it mean? How can good be the enemy of greatness? I'm sorry, what's your name again, sir? Muhammad. Tell me, Muhammad. No reach your full potential, right? I don't know if you guys care at home. We're all doing our best here, getting used to this, right? But sometimes if you're good at something, you kind of fall back on it, right? Like, oh, I've always been good at it. I might not have to work as hard at it, right? It could be a sport. Maybe you're good at acting. Maybe you're good in theater. Maybe you're good at something. You're good artist. You've always been good at it. You never really had to work at it. It always just came naturally. Well, sometimes that can be a bad thing because you never really tried to strive through it and really, really get to that next level. Right? And that's an amazing, amazing thing. So I think that's an important thing for all of us. Here comes the trucks next behind my room. Sorry about that, folks. But trying to get to that next level. Now, to make things more complicated, you get the outside, you know, truck noise. You know, this is great. All right. Now, for a college course, though, I think it relates. This is why I want to share with you guys today. Everyone in this room, both here and at home, had a choice to make. You could have taken Regents US, could even take an AP US. You chose this course. And for personally me, that means a lot to me. Because this is the course that I really hold dear. It's the course that I began, I started, and I'm glad you took it. And I thank all of you for taking it. And it also shows that you want to do something different, right? And maybe get to that next level and take a real college course in your junior year of high school. And honestly, this isn't even a freshman level college course. All the people I teach at Niagara are all sophomores and juniors and even some seniors in college, right? They're not freshmen. Is that a B? Is that a fly? Okay. Oh, it's a B. All right, we got him. All right, he's trapped. All right, just swatted that B. See that? Bam! Knocked that B out of there. Excitement at home, man. Live action. Bees in the room. Trucks in the background. This is, you're missing all the fun today, guys. This is great. All right, anyway. All right, so you went to that next level. All right, good is the enemy of greatness. Pride. I'll give you my take on pride. The P stands for pride. The R stands for resulting. The I stands for in. The D stands for daily. And the E stands for effort. Pride resulting in daily effort. That's important for taking a college level course. This course should be very doable for all of you. Honestly, college should be really doable. There's no reason in most college courses you shouldn't leave that course without at least getting a B. It's easy to get a B in a college course. To get a B in the college course, especially when you're actually on campus, what do? You show up. All right? That sounds like it's a given, but for a lot of college students, that's a challenge. You get to class. You go to class. Next way to get a B in a college course, turn stuff in on time. I'm not even saying it has to be outstanding work. You just turned your stuff in on time. You did those two things, you're probably going to get a B in a college course. Now to get an A, and in those A ranges, you got to do more, certainly. You got to work hard. You got to put your time into it. But if you take it bit by bit by bit, and I really hope this course will give you those skills if you don't have them already to do well in the class by taking it a little bit at a time. All right, now, I take a little pause, and I want to share with you some quick little video clips that will resonate with some of the themes that we're going to look at in class together over the next months. Okay, so this is actually a video clip from the movie Gettysburg. Anybody see the movie Gettysburg? Raise your hand at home too. Anybody ever see the movie Gettysburg? Wow, man, it's a huge, long film. It's based on a book called Killer Angels about the Civil War. It's a novel. And it details like the lives of three commanders of the Civil War. Robert E. Lee, James Longstreet, and this guy, Colonel Joshua Chamberlain. He's one of my favorite people from this American Civil War. He was a Union officer who fought for Maine. He was a college professor when the war broke out, so I like, he was a teacher. And he wanted to join the army, and the college wouldn't let him. So he left his job. He quit his job at the college to join the army. He had a very easy, nice life and said, I want to do something. He worked his way up the ranks, started as a nobody. By the middle of the Civil War, he becomes a colonel, is in charge of a regiment. He gets wounded on the battlefield multiple times. They almost think he dies in one battle. And when they think he's dead, they promote him to general. He survives that, so he leaves the war as a general. He wins the Congressional Medal of Honor and eventually becomes the governor of Maine. I mean, it's this great, like, awesome story of a person who just, you know, successful. In this particular clip, he's given a speech to a group of deserters. These are people who ran away from their regiment, and they were going to be either court-martialed or hanged, and he tries to get them to come back. He's going to forgive them if they just come back to his group and be part of the army. He's going to tell you why he thinks it's important in this one. This first clip is a little low. I apologize about that. The next two will be louder.
Men, gather around. I've been talking with Private Buckland. He's told me about your problem. There's nothing I can do today. We're moving out in a few minutes. We'll be moving all day. I've been ordered to take you men with me.
Sure.
I'm told that if you don't come, I can shoot you. Well, you know I won't do that. Maybe somebody else will. So, that's it. Here's the situation. The whole Reb Army took that road away is waiting for us. So this is no time for an argument like this. I tell you, we could surely use you fellas. We're now well below half strength. Whether you fight or not, that's up to you. Whether you come along is what? You're coming. You know who we are, what we're doing here, but if you're going to fight alongside us, there's a few things I want you to know. This regiment was formed last summer in Maine. There were 1,000 of us then. There are less than 300 of us now. All of us volunteered to fight for the Union, just as you did. Some came mainly because we were bored at home. Thought this looked like it might be fun. Some came because we were ashamed and not. Many of us came because it was the right thing to do. All of us have seen men die. This is a different kind of army. If you look back through history, you will see men fighting for women, for some other kind of loot, fight for land, power. Because a king leads them, or just because they like killing. We are here for something new. This has not happened much in the history of the world. We are an army out to set other men free. America should be free ground, all of it, not divided by a line between slave states and free, all the way from here to the Pacific Ocean. No man has to bow, no man born to royalty. Here we judge you by what you do, not by who your father is. Here you can be something. Here is the place to build a home. But it's not the land. There's always more land. It's the idea that we all have value. You and me. What we're fighting for. In the end. Fighting for each other.
Okay, I'm going to pause it there. Keila home, could you guys hear that okay at home or not? You guys can hear it? Okay, good. Awesome. Real quick, I mean, what was this different about this army? Like, why was it a different army? He's talking about the Army of the Potomac, the Union Army of the Civil War. What made it different, either at home or in class? What do you guys think? What made it different? You want to take a shot at that? Yeah, Muhammad, go ahead. And like you said, I'm sorry, my friend, give me a big old... Right, he's crazy. I'm sorry, one more time, my friend. We weren't just fighting for ourselves, is that what you said? No. Yeah, we'll work this out. I'm sorry. All right, I couldn't hear you. Maybe you want to type in the chat. It's crazy. Anyone want to help me out? What did he say? Did you hear him over here? Did you hear what he said either? You're that close? One more time, Muhammad. That thing's done. Yeah, thank you. It was between our country and ourselves. There was a civil war, which certainly made it unique. What else did he say? What made this army different? Maybe a home war I'd chime in too? What made it different? Anybody? Right. What were they fighting for? In the end, ultimately, he said at the very end, what were they fighting for? It was the most important thing they were fighting for in this army. Was it about land? Was it about money? Was it about power? They were fighting for whom? Freedom? Yeah, that's a big one, but they said the ultimate, at the end, they were fighting just for them. Who? For, let me catch it, each other. If you guys heard at the very end, that's a really important aspect. They were fighting for each other. And we're going to see as a common theme in military history. I don't care what war it is. I don't care if it's a civil war, Vietnam War, World War II. You ultimately ask a soldier, what are they fighting for? They're fighting for the person next to them. to make sure that person gets home and vice versa. And that's an amazing bond that the American Army usually has throughout its history. It goes so far. So we're going to get to that later. Awesome. Okay, next clip. This one's a little bit louder. Okay. I'm just going to share this. I'll tell you why. There we go.
In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the... Anyone?
Oh, I'm sorry. I went too fast. Ah, hold on. Technical difficulties. Thank you. There we go. I'll do it one more time.
In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the... Anyone? Anyone? The Great Depression passed... Anyone? Tariff bill, the Hawley-Smoot Tariff Act, which anyone raised or lowered? Raised tariffs in an effort to collect more revenue for the federal government. Did it work? Anyone? Anyone know the effects? It did not work, and the United States sank deeper into the Great Depression. Today, we have a similar debate over this. Anyone know what this is, class? Anyone? Anyone? Anyone seen this before? The Laffer Curve. Anyone know what this says? It says that at this point on the revenue curve, you will get exactly the same amount of revenue as at this point. This is very controversial. Does anyone know what Vice President Bush called this in 1980? Anyone? Something D-O-O economics, voodoo economics.
Okay, what movie is that from? Someone at home, only. What's the movie from? Tell me at home, please. Speak up. I know you guys know this. Jim, speak up, tell me.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Good job, Jim. All right. So how many of you seen that movie? Raise your hands at home, raise your hands in the classroom. All right, some of you haven't seen that movie. Oh my gosh, you gotta watch this movie. Please do. It's a funny movie from this time period. Why did I show you that? That room was very boring. Now, for me this year, our greatest challenge is to make sure that's not this room, which in some respects is gonna be hard because of the way you're set up, right? I don't want this class to be only just me yelling at you, speaking at you every single day. It's gotta be dynamic, it's gotta be interactive. We're gonna do the best we can to make it that way. And we will certainly do that. All right. Now, next clip. And this is actually, I got an idea. While I'm watching this clip, I got to keep reminding myself, I can't forget about some folks. How about we have rows 1 and rows 3 take a mass break while I'm watching this clip? Please remind me about that. It's an important thing. I want to make sure I don't forget about you guys doing that. Okay. So rows 1 and 3, this is 2 and 4 on the other end. So rooms 1 and row 3, take a little mass break. Here we go. At home, you don't need to.
I'm what? I'm being your goddamn slave is what I'm being, man. And we better deal here. So you're supposed to teach and I'm supposed to learn, remember? For 4 days, I've been busting my ass every other goddamn thing. I learned plenty. I learned how to sand your decks, maybe. I've washed your car, paint your house, paint your fence. I learned plenty, right?
Not everything is as simple.
Oh, bullshit. I'm going home, man.
Daniel-san.
What?
Come here. Show me sand the floor.
I can't move my arm, right? What are you doing? Ow! Ow, what are you doing?
Oh, show me sand the floor.
How did you do that?
Shut up!
Sand the floor.
Stand up. Show me sand the floor. Sand the floor. Sand the floor. Big sucker. Sand the floor. Sand the floor. Now show me wax on, wax off. Hey.
Wax on, wax off.
Wax on, wax off. Hey, wax on, hat. Wax off. Concentrate. Look in my eye. Lakahan, Sam Minsky, Hatson, Hat, Hats off, Hat, Hatson, Hat, Hats off, Hat, Hatson, Hats off, Bush, show me pentafence, up, down, up, down, up, down. Other side, look I, always look I. Show me paint the house, side, side. Black wrist, side, 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 side. Yes. Show me wax on, wax off. Yes! 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 Show me paint the fence. Yes! Yes! Death! Death! Show me side to side. Death! 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 Show me sand or floor. Death! 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 Yes! Yes! Death! Death! Oi! Hey! I always look alive. Come back tomorrow.
Okay. Get to the next one in a little bit. But what was the deal with that? If at home, and what was Daniel's problem? Why was he so upset and so frustrated at the beginning of that clip? How many of you have seen this whole movie? I should ask that question. How many of you have seen the whole Karate Kid movie, the original one? Only a few of you. Oh, my gosh. It's on Netflix again. Watch it. And there's actually a whole new Netflix series called Cobra Kai, where he's an older guy now, Daniel. He's in the series, but he's still the same character as an adult. It's crazy. Anyway, but what was his problem? Why was he so upset and frustrated when he first got there? Do you guys remember why? At home or in class? Why was he so frustrated? Anybody want to take a shot at it? Why was he so frustrated? He didn't understand what, why he was doing what. All these things. So he didn't see the movie. I guess the context is tough. So for weeks and days and months, he was like asking this guy to help him learn how to do karate. He goes, okay, I'll teach you. So what does he have him do? Weeks, he's waxing all this guy's cars. For weeks, he's painting all of his fences. He's sanding all of his decks. He's like, I'm not learning karate. What do you, you're just using me for free labor. But what was the reality was that as this was all going on, he was learning all the technique, you know, doing the fence, doing the deck, was all the technique for karate, that he didn't understand it. So he was frustrated because he didn't understand why he was learning or what he was learning. Now, you can raise your hand, you don't have to if you don't want to, but how many times have you been frustrated in a class because you didn't understand why you were doing what you were doing? Just raise your, be honest. You've all felt that way, right? And your comment was, what in the hell am I doing here? Why are we wasting our time doing this? This is crazy. I could be doing so many other things. So I want to make sure that you guys know in this course, I'm never waste your time. I'm always going to try to be very clear as possible of why we're doing a certain thing. We have a place to get to, and I know how to get there. And I want to make sure that along the way, we're going to get there together. And everything that we do together will help us get along that path, okay? Awesome. Okay, can my one and threes put your mask back on? Twos and fours, have a little mask break, please. We're going to watch something.
Thank you.
Pause that. Oh, I can't hit the play button. You pause that. Okay. So how many of you have set goals? Raise your hand at home too. How many of you have set goals for yourselves, right? Already in your lives. Does anybody want to share a goal they've set, either at home or here? Give me a goal. Yes, Miss. I'm sorry, what's your name again? Haley? University of Miami, right? Great goal for you. And you kind of get some ideas what you gotta do to get there, right? That's awesome. Thank you for sharing. Any other goals at home too? Please raise your hand or speak or just unmute yourself and speak up. Anybody else want to share a goal? Anybody? It's okay. I want you guys to get used to being comfortable in this class talking and being involved. It's okay. So it's a point where we always set goals. And one of the things we're going to do in this course is, yes, we're going to study military history, but we also study leadership. It's a big part of the course, actually. And one of the big things about leadership is that you have a goal. As a leader, you have a goal. You have a goal for yourself. You have a goal for those that you're leading. And no matter what you do in your life, you will one day, in one respect, be a leader. Whether it's at home, in a relationship, as a parent, or in your job, somewhere, somehow, something, you're going to be a leader one day. And that's an awful important responsibility. And we're going to study leadership. We're going to study about how to set goals and do all those awesome things. Ooh, so how'd you guys do at home? Did you guys do okay for first day at home? Everybody all right? You guys at home have a wonderful day. Just real quick, I didn't see Lucas Sanderson. I didn't see James Thompson. And I didn't see Travis. So I don't think I missed them. So if I didn't miss them, I didn't miss them. I just want to make sure I didn't miss anybody at home. So thank you. All right, folks. In class, everybody pretty good? Awesome, folks. At home, have a great day, okay? We'll see you guys, some of you in class tomorrow. Others, we'll see you online. Have a great day, everybody. See you later. Thanks, everybody. Here, I appreciate it.